Good evening. Welcome to God's house here at Good Shepherd tonight. Great to be with you here on this Ash Wednesday. So Ash Wednesday is the day where we think about repentance and the fact that even if we had only sinned once in our life, it would be too many. We would still be condemned because of that. And it's a day where we remember repentance and thinking about looking to Jesus alone as our only hope of forgiveness. So that's what we're doing tonight for that. And then we're also starting Lent today, and we're starting this series for Lent called God on Trial. Now, a lot of these services will be thinking about how different people in Jesus' passion history accused and kind of put him on trial. And really, if you think about it, people have been putting God on trial from the beginning. You know, from the time that Adam, you know, said to God, you know, the woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit and I ate it. People tend to kind of start to blame God for different things. And we'll think tonight about how even we can do that in a way and accuse God of not treating us how we deserve. So we'll think about that for our service tonight. So with that, we will begin then with our opening hymn, Come to Calvary's Holy Mountain. Please stand. For our order of service tonight, we'll follow the service in your worship folder and on the screen behind me. We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, God created us to know joy in fellowship with Him, to love all people, and to live in harmony with all creation. But sin separates us from God, our neighbors, and creation. And so we do not enjoy the life our Creator intended for us. By our sin, we grieve our Father, who does not desire us to come under His judgment, but to turn to Him and live. Therefore, God in His mercy has sent our Lord Jesus Christ to take our place under the law, to suffer for us, and to die the death we deserve. God made Jesus, who had no sin, to be sin for us, so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God. During the 40 days of Lent, we fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before Him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of God. The time of Lent reminds us that to know Christ and the power of his resurrection, we must also know the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. As disciples of the Lord Jesus, we are called to struggle against everything that leads us away from love of God and neighbor. So let us confess our sins, ask our Father for forgiveness, and commit ourselves to this struggle. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let us confess our sins to the Lord. Holy God, gracious Father, I am sinful by nature and have sinned against you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have not loved you with my whole heart. I have not loved others as I should. I deserve your punishment both now and forever. But Jesus, my Savior, paid for my sins with his innocent suffering and death. Trusting in him, I pray, God have mercy on me, a sinner. Our gracious Father in heaven has been merciful to us. He sent his only Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life as the atoning sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, you never despise what you have made and always forgive those who turn to you. Create in us such new and contrite hearts that we may truly repent of our sins and obtain your full and gracious pardon. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And you may be seated. Our God speaks to us in his word, first of all, from the book of the Old Testament prophet Joel, chapter 2. And the prophet Joel wrote to God's people when they went through some difficulties, and he's calling on them here to, you know, turn away from their sins, repent, and turn to him, which is what still God wants us to do, turn from our sins and look to our Savior. So we read from Joel, chapter 2. Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Rend your heart and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love, and he relents from sending calamity. Who knows? He may turn and relent and leave behind a blessing, grain offerings and drink offerings for the Lord your God. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Declare a holy fast. Call a sacred assembly. Gather the people, consecrate the assembly. Bring together the elders, gather the children, those nursing at the breast. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her chamber. Let the priests who minister before the Lord weep between the portico and the altar. Let them say, spare your people, Lord. Do not make your inheritance an object of scorn, a byword among the nations. Why should they say among the peoples, where is their God? Then the Lord was jealous for his land and took pity on his people. The Lord replied to them, I am sending you grain, new wine, and olive oil, enough to satisfy you fully. Never again will I make you an object of scorn to the nations. The word of the Lord. And we'll continue with the song from the choir.
Thank you.
Our God also speaks to us in his word in the New Testament book of Revelation, chapter 3. And this is the section where Jesus writes letters to different churches, and he kind of gives them all different things to think about. And this church in Sardis, he sort of says, you think you're doing great, but you're not. Your faith isn't in a good place. And it's a reminder for everyone, whether that's true for us or not, it's staying and continuing in repentance and continuing God's word is how he keeps our faith strong. So we read from Revelation chapter 3. To the angel of the church in Sardis write, these are the words of him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wake up. Strengthen what remains and is about to die, for I have found your deeds unfinished in the sight of my God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard. Hold it fast and repent. But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come to you. The word of the Lord. And I invite you to please stand for the reading of the gospel. The gospel for tonight is from the gospel according to Luke chapter 12. And here Jesus reminds us that sometimes the thing that can get in the way of a repentant life, sometimes are the very things that God blesses us with, the material possessions we have, which we're meant to use for our good. We don't want them, though, to get in the way of our relationship with our God. So we read from Luke 12. Someone in the crowd said to him, and him is Jesus, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." Jesus replied, "Man, who appointed me a judge or an arbiter between you?" Then he said to them, "Watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions." And he told them this parable. The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, "What shall I do? I have no place to store my crops." Then he said, "This is what I'll do. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones, and there I will store my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, 'You have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself?' This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves, but is not rich toward God." The gospel of the Lord. And you may be seated for the next hymn. Grace, mercy, and peace are yours from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Friends, accusations are a very powerful thing. You know, for someone to look at you, and I won't, despite what I talked about with some people outside, I will not, you know, point and call your specific names. But if you were, you know, if someone says something and said, you messed this up, you know, you dropped the ball on this, you know, it can give you a physical reaction sometime. And then you think of, you know, some very serious accusations. And we'll even not even think about, you know, whether the accusation sometimes is true or false. The accusation itself can have big consequences, right? People have had their reputations ruined. People have lost jobs. People have been convicted of crimes. And it started with an accusation in many cases. What we maybe don't think about very much is the idea of us accusing God, right? Pointing our finger, but up in the sky. Someone might do it jokingly sometimes, but for the most part, we would think, oh, that's not really me. I'm not going to be accusing God of things. But really, especially when we think of, and this is what we'll see in future weeks of this series on our midweek Lenten services, but people, you know, didn't treat Jesus very well and, of course, accused him of many terrible things. But also people have accused God over the years, including the person in our text for tonight. We're looking at the book of Job, and this is one of those stories that the book of Job is, I will say, is a tough one to read sometimes. Not that the words are hard, but it's a long book. It's kind of a downer sometimes. There's a lot of bad things that happen. There's a lot of people angry and feeling terrible, and you know it can be kind of hard to read, but the overall message is very important for us. But so in the book of Job, and Job, you know, even people who have never heard of the Bible might know the name Job, and they might think of, you know, he's famous for his patience and maybe famous for his suffering. And there's a good reason he's famous, because he went through some really terrible things. Job was very wealthy, and it seems like, first of all, that he's a good guy. You know, it says he was a, you know, an upstanding, upright man. You know, he wasn't some guy who was committing crimes and doing terrible things. You know, he was a good guy. And then we hear that one night he was very wealthy. He had all this sorts of livestock, all different animals. And in one night, those animals were either stolen and the people who cared for them killed. I believe it says he lost 10,000 different, you know, types of animals of his livestock. And so he gets told that this has happened. And then shortly after that, he also gets told that his children, and it seems that he had, it didn't seem like they were young children at this point. It's hard to tell what their ages are, but they were all together, all 10 of his children. I believe he had 7 sons and 3 daughters, and they were all killed. A windstorm hit the house, and it collapsed on them, and they all died all at once. And so you think of when someone might start to accuse God, you know, someone has all these bad things happen. But when this happened to Job, maybe you've even heard his response before. This is what he said. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised. He had, you know, it's almost amazing to think of someone having that kind of attitude with it. And we're even told, you know, in all this, Job did not sin by charging God with wrongdoing. All right, so he wasn't accusing God at this point. It didn't stop there, though. Then it started to affect his body. We're told that he got, it's described as boils. So I don't know, you know, if this is kind of like a full skin infection. We're told from the soles of his feet to the top of his head, he just had sores all over him. And the only thing he could do for comfort, if you can even call it comfort, is he would take a broken piece of pottery and just kind of scrape his skin with it, would be the closest thing to relief. And again, it sounds miserable, and I'm sure it was. And so at this time, we're told, now his wife is around. You know, his kids were killed, but his wife wasn't. But listen to what his wife says. This is in the next chapter, I think. His wife said to him, "Are you still maintaining your integrity? Curse God and die." You know, she was sort of saying, this is the worst thing that could possibly happen. And how can you have anything good to say about God at this point? You know, you should be cursing him. But still, you know, Job kept being patient about it. You know, he replied, "You are talking like a foolish woman. Shall we accept good from God and not trouble?" In all this, Job did not sin in what he said. So again, he still, you know, toughed it out, you could say. Then we're told in Job that his friends show up. And you think, well, things will get better now, right? Because his friends are going to show up and they'll, you know, give him a there, and everyone will start feeling better. And it sort of starts that way. His friends show up, and first they just sit with him in silence, I think for many days, we're told. And then they start talking, and that's where the trouble starts. Because the friends sort of say to him, you know, Job, we always thought you're a great guy, and we know God is good. We know God is perfect. So the fact that all these things happened to you have told us one thing. You must have done something really wrong. They sort of accused, we could say, Job of, there must be some sort of skeleton in his closet, so to speak, right? He must have done something really terrible, and Job, you know, you'd just feel better if you let it out. Just tell us whatever it was, you know, we'll be here for you. But let it out and, you know, tell us what this horrible thing was and why God has decided to punish you like this. And the thing was, you know, again, Job wasn't perfect, but he really was a fine, upstanding person, you know, as far as, you know, even, you know, if you really were to compare people, you know, from what it sounds and the way God describes in the book of Job, Job was right up there. And he hadn't done some huge, you know, he didn't kill someone. He didn't have some big problem, you know. Again, he's a sinful person, but there wasn't some big thing. And as the friends kept talking to them, then we see Job kind of start to lose it. And now he does accuse his friends a bit of, you know, why are you showing up here only to yell at me and accuse me of wrongdoing? But then he starts pointing the finger up at God a little bit. And we see a little bit of it here. You know, he's kind of frustrated saying to God, if I have sinned, what have I done to you, you who sees everything we do? Why have you made me your target? Have I become a burden to you? And again, this goes on for, you know, I think the whole book of Job is 40 chapters. It keeps going like this. And, you know, we sort of think, and this is a very extreme case, of course. You know, he goes through terrible suffering, and then he does start blaming God. And so, you know, we think, you know, could that ever be something that we would do? And you probably heard of people who have struggled with this, or maybe it's something that you've realized that you struggle with, because there are times, you know, people who lose someone that they love, someone really close to them, and even sometimes they'll say, you know, I know better, but sometimes I want to say, God, why did you let this happen? Or there's sometimes we go through other struggles, and maybe, you know, maybe we never have quite the sentence in our mind or on our lips saying, you know, I blame you, God. You know, maybe we wouldn't say it that way. I mean, maybe we would. It depends on the situation, I suppose. But regardless, there's that little thing of, again, we can sort of lay out the facts. We can think, all right, a bad thing has happened to me. And then we can think, well, I know God is all-powerful. I know he's good. He says he loves me. And then there's a part of us that thinks, well, why didn't he stop the bad thing? Whatever it was, why didn't he stop that from happening? You know, whether it was, again, a death, whether it was a sickness, whether it was a, you know, a dire financial situation that caused all sorts of problems, whether it was a relationship that, you know, went into really difficult territory, you know, and there's a part where someone might say, why me? Why right now? And there might even be a part of us in those times that would say, again, maybe we'd think this in so many words, maybe we wouldn't, but there'd be that little hint of, you know, God, I'm one of the good ones, right? Ash Wednesday evening service, I'll come or I'll watch it online. You know, I'm there. I'm trying to do the right thing. You know, I'm not trying to go on a crime spree here. You know, I'm not perfect, of course, but I'm trying. And then these things happen. And then I might see other people where this doesn't happen to them. And you start trying to do some math, and I don't know how the equations add up, but it seems like it leaves you with a big question mark. Why does God let this happen? And we might not think of that as an accusation, but really, you know, we're kind of telling God, you know, are you really taking care of me like you promised? Are you really showing the love to me that I was pretty sure your word talked about how much you love me, yet the evidence I see doesn't match up to it? And sometimes we think, well, it would be interesting to hear what God would say, wouldn't it? You know, if he would say, okay, I'll level with you. Here's why it happened in your case. Maybe we'd want to know, maybe we wouldn't. But Job actually got that chance. And that's what we see in our text. Job actually, you know, he most of the book he spends saying, man, I wish God would just, you know, listen to me and I could give him a piece of my mind. Well, at the very end, God appears. There's a big storm and this whole thing. And then God shows up. And, you know, we're not going to read too much of it, but, you know, it says, we just hear, the Lord said to Job, will the one who contends with the Almighty correct him? Let him who accuses God answer him. So Job had all sorts of questions for God, but when God appears, God says, Job, I got a few questions for you. And like I said, we're not going to read it because it goes on a few chapters, but God basically says, hey, Job, where were you when I created the world? Where were you when, you know, I decided where the oceans would end and the shore would begin? Where were you when I made sure that different animals in the forest, you know, can feed their young? And, you know, he keeps going like this, God does. And he's sort of saying, Job, who are you to question me? You're a human being and I'm God. And Job actually, you know, he gets the message. And again, it'd be interesting to see what this really looked like of God talking to him. But then a couple chapters later, you know, we hear Job replied to the Lord, and he's not talking so big at this point. I know that you can do all things. No purpose of yours can be thwarted. You asked, who is this that obscures my plans without knowledge? Surely I spoke of things I did not understand, things too wonderful for me to know. You said, listen now, and I will speak. I will question you, and you shall answer me. My ears have heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore, I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. So once he got the answer from God, he just realized there's nothing I can say anymore. And it's interesting because God doesn't say, by the way, Job, here's why I allowed this to happen. Here's the exact reason, and here's how it's going to be okay. And some of us, you know, if you read the whole story, God does restore Job's fortune. And things go better for him at the end. But still we think about this, and we think about that accusing God, and we think about, again, wondering, you know, is God treating me right? And then realize kind of how foolish it is to ask God that. God who says, be perfect. And every one of us, even the Jobs, even the people who, you know, everyone would say, oh, I want to be like this person, you know, even that person falls far short of the perfection God demands. And if you think about it, any thought of, you know, I want God to treat me fairly, treat me like I deserve, there couldn't be anything worse than God treating us like we deserved. Again, because he says, the wages of sin is death. You know, what should come to all of us, you know, and not even to mention troubles in this world, God says there's troubles in the world to come. There's eternal death is really what you deserve, you know, if you were to accuse me. And that's where, and that's why I think this Lenten season is so much a blessing for us, where we get to keep our eyes on Jesus, who came to take our place under what we really do deserve, right? Because Jesus came and paid the price that we deserve. Jesus came and, you know, with his suffering and his death, you know, really he was paying for the sins of the whole world. You know, we think, you know, we want to accuse God and God could very easily, you know, turn the pointing finger back on ourselves. But really all those accusations, all the sins we've committed, every wrong ever done was laid on Jesus. And he paid the price so that we wouldn't have to. And thankfully, Job even got to know that too. You know, where he eventually said one of the most famous verses in the Bible, you know, where he says, I know that my Redeemer lives and that in the end he will stand on the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes, I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. So, you know, Job, God God gave him that faith to trust that there would be a Savior. You know, he wasn't born yet at that point, but there would be a Savior, and he would see him, and he would live. And thank God that's the Savior that we get to follow to the cross this Lent. And to know that, a lot of accusations, and he was put literally on trial, and he took the full punishment. Not that he deserved. He didn't deserve any of it. He took the full punishment that every human being, including all of us, deserved. And he's taken it away. And because of him, we know, we're forgiven. Because of him, we know, whatever trouble I face in this world, God does still love me. And he has promised to be with me. And yes, he hasn't promised to remove every trouble in this world, out of my path. But he has promised to be with me during them. And he has promised in Jesus, he's won me eternal life. And forever of having no problems. That's what's waiting for us because of Jesus. So again, we get this chance for another Lent season to follow Jesus to the cross, to see the injustices of the world, to see the accusations pointed at him. And even in that, I suppose, what could be a terrible story, we get to rejoice because Jesus did it for us. Jesus took the accusations that should have been ours and paid the price we should have paid. And because of that, we live and we're forgiven. Amen. I invite you then to please stand. And we'll take this time to confess our faith in the triune God. And we'll do that using the words of the Nicene Creed. So I invite you to say these words along with me. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. And we'll continue with the prayer of the church, the responsive prayer of the church, as it's printed for you. Now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. Let us pray for the people of God in Christ Jesus, that through repentance and faith in the gospel, they may remain secure in your love. Lord God, gracious Father, we thank you for setting your Son's sacrifice between us and sin's reward. By your Spirit, work in us through the gospel. Give us repentant hearts. Make our faith firm in Christ and enliven us to serve you faithfully. Lord God, Almighty Father, renew your church throughout the world that it may constantly look to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. Bless us with faithful ministers who always proclaim Christ's cross and resurrection for the salvation of the world. Lord God, loving Father, in your mercy you abundantly supply our needs of body and soul. Create in us the mind of Christ, that in humility and generosity, considering not only our own interests, but also the interests of others, we may be merciful to those in need. Direct our efforts to help poor, lonely, troubled, and ill people. Lord God, Heavenly Father, comfort all who are mourning the death of people they loved. Lift their eyes to the cross where your Son defeated death, and to the empty tomb where he assured us that we will live with him forever. Teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Lord God, Heavenly Father, look with favor upon all sick, injured, and recovering people. If it be your will, deliver them from their infirmities. Let them hear of your unfailing love.
Have mercy on us, Lord, according to your unfailing love.
Hear us, Lord, as we pray in silence. Lord God, eternal Father, we praise you that you have delivered the Christian souls who have gone before us from this world of dust and ashes to paradise. As their prayers continually ascend before your throne, join our prayers to theirs as fragrant incense. Hear us for the sake of him who was crucified for us and always intercedes on our behalf, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We'll continue at this time with the offering. While the offering is being gathered, I invite you to fill out the Connect card in each row, and those viewing online can fill out the online Connect card also. Thanks. Please stand. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who brought the gift of salvation to all people by his death on the tree of the cross, so that the devil who overcame us by a tree would in turn by a tree be overcome. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song. We give thanks to you, O God, through your dear Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent to be our Savior, our Redeemer, and the messenger of your grace. Through him you made all things. In him you are well pleased. He is the incarnate Word, conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. To fulfill your promises, he stretched out his hands on the cross and released from eternal death all who believe in you. As we remember Jesus' death and resurrection, we thank you that you have gathered us together to receive your Son's body and blood. Send us your Spirit, unite us as one, and strengthen our faith so that we may praise you in your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we glorify and honor you, O God our Father, with the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." And the peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Be seated. This time we invite those who are coming to the Lord's table to come at the direction of the ushers and come for all things have been prepared. Thank you. Please stand. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup,
we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
We give thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with this saving gift. We pray that through it you will strengthen our faith in you and increase our love for one another. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We'll close with the closing hymn. You may be seated. Once again, good evening and welcome to Good Shepherd. It's great to be with you here tonight to praise our God together and receive his gifts to us in word and sacrament. So the midweek Wednesday Lenten services, will not include the 7 p.m. service after tonight. So I'm glad you guys can make it for this one. But after this, it'll be 4:30. And then it will be online later for people who just can't make it because of the timing of it. The future ones will also be a part of Faith Night. So it'll be a 4:30 p.m. service. And then the meal after the service / Faith Night meal starts at 5:30. And then the regular Faith Night Bible studies will start at 6. So that's how it'll go for the next few weeks. There's a total of 6 Wednesdays, and this is the first one. So we got a little time yet for the Lent services. So with that, God's blessings to you all tonight. Careful outside. We're not used to this snow again, so be careful and while you're driving. And God's blessings. We'll see you again.